Hello, I'm Simon Whistler. You're watching Today I Found Out, and in the video today we're answering a subscriber question because Brian S. asks, how did they get the spaceships on the moon off when there is no oxygen there? Whether it's two strokes, or four, one cylinder, or eight, most of the engines we use today are powered by the internal combustion of fuel and of air. However, mixing gasoline and oxygen, it's not the only way to generate the energy needed to propel a craft, and in fact, sometimes it's actually the least useful choice. And this, well, this is where rockets enter the picture. A rocket doesn't rely on a crankshaft, but rather the expulsion of something, be it gas, liquid, solid, or simply radiant energy, through a small opening known as a nozzle. Therefore, unlike a truck that doesn't need to carry its oxidizer since it can draw sufficient oxygen from its surrounding environment, ships with rocket engines have to carry all of their propellant with them, even just to get off the ground when there is an oxygen-rich environment. Of course, it would be impractical to haul enough gaseous oxygen up into space to have a meaningful flight. To get around this problem, alternatives have been developed, primarily in the forms of solid and liquid propellants. Solid propellants come in two main types, homogeneous and composite. With both, the fuel and the oxidizer are stored together, and power is produced when the two are ignited. Homogeneous solid propellants are unique in that both the oxidizer and the fuel exist together as a single, unstable compound, either as simply nitrocellulose or together with nitroglycerine. On the other hand, with composite solid propellants, the fuel and the oxidizer are distinct materials that have been combined into a powdery or crystallized mixture, which is commonly comprised of ammonium nitrate or chlorate, or potassium chlorate as the oxidizer, and some type of solid hydrocarbon fuel, similar to asphalt or plastic. Solid propellants have long been used with launch vehicles, including the Space Shuttle's launch boosters that each produced 3.3 million pounds of thrust. With liquid propellants, well, there are three main types: petroleum-based, cryogenic, and hypergolic. All three of these propulsion methods store their oxidizers and fuels separately until thrust is needed. When rockets fueled with a liquid propellant are fired, a bit of each fuel, fuel and oxidizer, is introduced into a combustion chamber where they combine and ultimately explode, producing the necessary power. Petroleum-based liquid propellants, as the name implies, mix together a petroleum product like kerosene with liquid oxygen, which, being highly concentrated, renders it an efficient and powerful propellant. As such, this method was widely used for many rockets, including the first stages of Saturn 1, 1B, and 5, as well as Soyuz. Another liquid propellant relies on cryogenic, super-low-temperature liquefied gases. One common method mixes liquefied hydrogen, the fuel, with liquefied oxygen, the oxidizer. Highly efficient, but difficult to store for long because of the need to keep both so cold, hydrogen stays liquid at minus 423 Fahrenheit, that's minus 253 Celsius, and oxygen at minus 297 degrees Fahrenheit, or minus 183 degrees Celsius. Cryogenic propellants, they have been used only in limited applications, although these include the main engines of the Space Shuttle and certain stages of the Delta IV and some of the Saturn rockets. With both petroleum-based and cryogenic propellants, some type of ignition is required, either via pyrotechnic, chemical, or electrical means. However, with the third type of liquid propellant, hypergolic, no ignition is necessary. Common hypergolic fuels include different forms of hydrazine, including unsymmetrical dimethylhydrazine and monomethylhydrazine. In these cases, nitrogen tetroxide is often used as the oxidizer. Liquid, even at room temperature, hypergolic propellants, they are easy to store, which, together with their spontaneous combustibility, make them highly desirable for a number of applications, such as in maneuvering systems. Therefore, even though the materials involved are highly toxic and corrosive, hyperbolic fuels have been frequently used, including in the Space Shuttle's orbiting maneuvering system and, pertinent to the question at hand, the Apollo Lunar Module, or LM. Four subcontractors worked under the lead contractor, Grumman Corporation, to build the LM, with Bell Aerosystems Company selected for the development of its ascent propulsion. Work began on the project in July of 1963, yet engineers were still tinkering with the ascent engine as late as September 1968, when Bell's initial propellant injector was switched out for one designed by Rocketdyne, the subcontractor that also built the descent engine. Driven by a non-gimbaled fixed-thrust engine and powered by an aerozine 50 fuel and nitrogen tetroxide oxidizer, the hypergolic materials that provided the thrust necessary to get the LM off the moon's surface were so corrosive that they burned through the engine each time they were fired, requiring the engine to be rebuilt. Of course, as a result of this, it meant that none of the actual engines used on the LMs were tested or fired prior to lifting the Apollo astronauts off the moon. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please do hit that thumbs up button below. And do not forget to subscribe for brand new videos just like this every day of the week. Also, I'd like to take this moment to thank our patrons on Patreon if you're interested in supporting us with a small financial contribution and getting some great perks in return. Please do consider heading over to patreon.com/todayIFoundOut. And as always, thank you for watching.